And hello, everyone. My name is Alberto, and I am speaking from Brazil. I am in the Assessment Services team, and it's a pleasure to be delivering the webinar once again. So now on to my colleague, Sarah.
So hello, yes, and I'm Sarah Ellis. I'm also in the Assessment Services team, but I'm based in Italy. And of course, it's a great pleasure to be here with Alberto today. So thank you very much for joining us for this session. And as you know, we're going to be looking at how to use speaking test videos to prepare learners for their Cambridge exams. So let's get started, Alberto.
Yeah, so here's the outline, Sarah.
Absolutely. So just very briefly, we're going to be looking at the reasons for using speaking test videos. And of course, that includes getting to know the speaking test and the different parts of the speaking tests, whether that's at C2 first or first for schools, or B2 first for schools, or B2 first, C1 advanced, and C2 proficiency. So we're going to be looking at those three different levels. Of course, we're going to be talking about understanding the assessment criteria, and in particular, we'll focus on part 1 and consider the spoken questions at the beginning of the test. And then we'll be moving on to look in more detail at part 2 and using images that help you prompt the speaking during that part of the test. And again, we're going to stop and focus on understanding the assessment criteria, which of course is very important for everyone. And throughout the video, we'll also be talking about resources and how to find more of the resources so that you can prepare and you can help your learners prepare. And finally, we'll have time at the end for some questions and answers, and we hope to answer as many as possible. Kate will be answering during the session, and then we'll leave some to answer at the end of the session. So the first question, why use speaking test videos? Well, there are lots of reasons, and some of you may have been able to watch the video with our colleagues, Claire and Matt, who also talked about using the speaking test videos at A2 and B1. And of course, you'll be able to watch the recording of that session if you didn't see it. And they also outlined the reasons for using speaking test videos, which of course are understanding the exam. The video show real candidates and real examiners so that learners can see what the experience is like. And of course, we have examples for different levels. Today, we're focusing on B1, C2, and B2, C1, and C2. But of course, the videos are available for all the levels. And of course, it shows what it's like to do the exam. Very importantly, you can see examples of candidates taking the exam as a pair, or if there are an uneven number of candidates, at the end of the session, there will be a group of 3 candidates, and we'll see examples of that too. Of course, the videos provide a realistic speaking model, so you can see that it's not about being perfect, it's about being able to do the tasks and about using your English at the level that you're taking the test with. So hopefully that will reassure candidates that they can do it. And of course, the first part is about getting to know the speaking test. And there are lots of resources on the website. So we show you here the exam preparation page from the website. And this, of course, will allow you to find the videos and also to help you get familiar with the format of the speaking test, which is the main aim of actually being able to use the videos. Second, also, we have other reasons, of course, is to build the confidence of the learners about the speaking test, and they feel fully informed about what's going to happen. And in preparation for any exam, we obviously recommend that you look at the speaking test, the exam that your learners are going to take. And before class, you might decide to watch the video at the level that you're interested in, and to choose to write down some questions that you want your learners to listen for when they're watching the video, and obviously looking at what happens during the speaking test.
And we have the QR code, Sarah, for anyone who wants to access the exam preparation section in our global website.
So there's lots of information for all the levels, as you can see. And then we're going to focus on these levels here today, B2 first for schools, C1 advanced, and C2 proficiency, which you can see here. Again, the QR code will help you. And that will take you also to the speaking test videos. And very importantly, you can see examples at all the levels, but you could also see examiners' comments for each of the videos as well. And we're very excited because there are new videos which are just being posted. They've been recorded in different places around the world. So you see examples of candidates in Brazil, in Italy, in Spain, and in other countries as well. So it's also very interesting that you can see how it's the same around the world.
Okay, and we are going to be sharing some tasks for you, some ways of using those speaking test videos. But in general terms, what we're going to do is we're going to propose that you follow three steps. For example, before you watch activities, and then we're going to propose some while you watch activities, and of course, after you watch activities. The idea here is that we share some samples, and then you can adapt those activities to any videos, any levels, or any parts of the speaking test. So as long as you follow the before, while, after approach that we're going to propose here, that will give you lots of ideas to work with those speaking test videos.
Now, before we look at those, we just wanted to say something about the three levels of the test. And here we can see the different tasks in each part, each exam. And obviously, this information is available in the teacher's handbook, so we'll be talking about that in a moment. But just to notice that in the test, some of the parts are very similar. And you can see, for example, at B2 first, we start with some spoken questions, and also at C1 Advanced, and also at C2 Proficiency. We start with those spoken questions, which focus on general interaction and social language, as you might expect when you meet someone new. Then we have part two, which again, at B2 First for Schools and C1 Advanced, we have what we call the long term, where students will speak on their own and then the second candidate will respond, and they're talking about photos. This is focusing on a longer piece of discourse and asking the students to compare and describe, and we'll look exactly at the kind of language they're expected to use in those parts. In C2, again, we're focusing on again, communication and sustaining interaction and exchanging ideas, expressing and justifying opinions, etc., and reaching a decision through negotiation. And if you like, the long term in proficiency is actually part three of the test, so it's slightly different order. So again, all this information you'll be able to see in the handbooks as we move forward. The last part, the part three in B2, and in C1 is what we call the collaborative task. And again, it's looking at spoken interaction, sustaining interaction, and exchanging and expressing ideas, justifying opinions, agreeing and disagreeing, speculating. And we'll come back to the actual language that students will be using in that part of the test. Finally, we go move on to a discussion related to the topic of the collaborative task. And again, it's an opportunity for candidates to express, justify, speculate, and agree and disagree. And we have the QR code here, don't we, Alberto?
Yes, the QR code will take you to the area where you can access the handbooks for teachers. And of course, there are differences in terms of lengths for the speaking test, depending on the level. And you have all the information in the handbooks for teachers, right? That you can download from this QR code. So thank you, Sarah. We are now going to talk about questions for part one. So as I mentioned, we are going to propose activities for you to do the before you watch, while you watch, and then the after you watch the videos. So just to give you an idea, this is the usual setup of the speaking test for those levels. We have two examiners, right, Sarah? One examiner is the interlocutor, the one who talks to the candidates. And the other examiner is the assessor who sits and listens to the students carefully but quietly. The usual setup includes two candidates and two examiners, but you might have also a trio, and then if there is an odd number of candidates in the session. So just to give you an idea of what the speaking test is like, if you haven't had the experience to see it, but you can see all of them in the videos, right? And for the purposes of this task, one of the activities that we propose before students watch the video is to ask them questions such as, how many candidates can they see in the speaking test? How many examiners? and then ask, get them to consider things about the examiners. Do they look friendly? And also other questions, for example, if they're doing the speaking test, what kind of questions will the examiners ask? So students can do a little bit of prediction before they watch the first part of the speaking test in the video. And then you can choose whichever video you want, right? So the idea here is that if the students cannot think of topics, you can prompt by saying, do you think the examiner will ask about you and your family? And then they can also predict, a number of topics. One of the things that happens as part of the routine of the exam is that after the introduction, the examiners will always ask about the student's name. So this is already a way of breaking the ice. And that happens regardless of the video. So here I have a short clip of this C2 proficiency test, where even though it is the highest level of the exam, the routine is the same. For example.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Kay Welsh, and this is my colleague, Victoria. And your names are?
My name is Manuel.
Manuel.
I'm Jules.
Jules.
And my name is Tiago.
And Tiago.
So even though this is a very short clip and this is the highest level of our exams, they still start with the what's your name first. And then you can tell the learners that, for example, the trainer, the examiners are trained to be friendly, and also they are trained to make candidates feel comfortable during the speaking test. And when the, for example, for the next part, if the examiners show the pictures on the video, you can pause the video so that students can look at the pictures, and then you can ask them questions, etc. We are going to talk about pictures in a moment. So this is good because you can, for example, give learners a few minutes to make a list of all the things they can see in the pictures in case there is a picture in the task, right? And then you can tell the learners to take the things they see and they hear from the video as they watch the parts of the video. This is a good way to check prediction, and you are using the video as a listening activity as well. And of course, you can play different parts of the video like we did just now. And then you can also ask the learners to listen and write down facts about the candidates in the video, for example, their age, their likes or dislikes. As I said, you use the video first to set a model. You use it as a listening activity, and then learners can do other activities in pairs or groups. For example, they can answer questions such as, what would you have done differently? This is interesting because you already lead the learners to be critical about the candidates on the video, in the sense that they will assess performance, and then they can compare the performance of the candidates with their own performance as well. And you can also ask them questions such as, which parts of the test did you think would be more demanding for you? So students can already relate to the different parts of the activity, and you will lead them to understand what to expect from the speaking test, right? Of course, you can prepare a set of questions as well, because part one, like Sarah showed, focuses a lot on questions. You can prepare a set of questions, and you can use the questions from the handbook for teachers where you have the examiner's script. So here we are going to give you an example. You're going to look at a list of questions that the students, that the examiners can ask, right? So here is a list of questions from the exam C1 Advanced. As I said, you can find those questions from the examiner's script, which is in the handbook for teachers. So we're going to watch a short clip, right? And as you watch the clip, I have two questions for you. Which questions out of the list did the examiner ask? And also, do the candidates extend their answer by giving a reason? So you have two things to listen out for. Which questions did the examiner ask? And do the candidates extend the answer by giving a reason? So you can write your answers in the chat by just typing the number of the question you hear or the questions that you hear. Sarah, please let me know whether
yes,
or
absolutely.
Not they are
and
answering
it
the
is
questions.
Absolutely. And of course, it's a good moment to say that, yes, there's a kind of selection of questions in the handbook, but of course, the examiner is not going to use all of them. So it's very nice to be able to use the questions, get students to concentrate on hearing which ones they actually ask. But of course, they won't get asked all of them.
Exactly. So thank you very much, Sarah. So,
Teresa, if you could live anywhere in the world, where would it be?
I personally think it would be London. It's very well connected to the rest of Europe and also to America. And I actually really like the culture and also the dishes. They're really good.
And Antonio, what do you like to do in your spare time?
I usually go out and go to the gym and get some exercise. And then I'll listen to music or dance to music as well.
And Teresa, what are your plans for the next few months?
My family and I, we are going to go to France to visit Paris, and also my family that it has been there for around 5 years.
And Antonio, what are your, no, do you think you study best when you're in a group?
Well, personally, I don't because I think you get distracted because you start talking about other things, but I think it can also help you to understand, like, a bit of pressure. It gives you pressure and understanding to how working with groups is.
Okay,
lots of
so
answers
Sarah.
In the chat, lots of answers. Yes, I think people have got heard the right ones, absolutely.
You will be my eyes in the chat, Sarah. So do you think the candidates extend the answers by giving reasons, or do you think there was a question or two that they didn't give a reason for?
That's interesting. See if anybody says in the chat.
Yeah.
Yeah, somebody said no, they didn't extend all of them. The third one wasn't extended, was the comment, but someone there.
Wow, that's nice. Thank you very much, everyone, for participating, for being so attentive, because Sarah, look at this. Yes, the examiner made, you know, choices. So she chose four questions. The candidates answered those four questions and they give reasons except for question number three. So the student could have given a reason for why he goes to the gym, etc. But this is just to give you an idea of how you can work with those questions with students, right, Sarah? Because you have them on the handbook, but you can make choices.
And I think it's really nice that students see the variety of questions that they can be asked, so they can be ready for any question that talks about them themselves. So, and I think now in the next exercise, we can show a variety of ways of practicing this, which is by using, this is only one, but it's one of the apps that we like to use, which is Pick a Wheel, and it's free to use. And basically, you can input the questions into the wheel so that when you spin the wheel, the students won't know which question is going to come up. So again, it's that anticipating the question and being able to respond without knowing exactly what question they're going to be asked. So I think you're going to give a quick demonstration, aren't you, Alberto?
Exactly. I'll do a demonstration with the questions that we used in the previous slide. So this is how it works.
There you go. You don't know what question you're going to get. It makes it more interesting.
Exactly. And then they can work in pairs, and then you can bring a lot more, communication to the tasks in class. So thank you, Sarah. So apart from
I think there
Pick a
are,
Wheel,
just to say, I think there's also other apps like WordWall and other ones that people are mentioning they can also use to do something similar. So yes, lots of things, but the important thing is that opportunity to practice questions when they're not quite sure which question they're going to get.
Exactly. And it brings variety to the lessons as well. What you could do next after using Pick a Wheel or Word Wall, for example, you could get learners to act out the exam, the speaking exam test. For example, one learner could role play the examiner and then the student, and then they could practice asking and answering questions, etc., as if they were on the exam day. And then you can also remind learners about tips for the exam, such as extending their answers and giving reasons for why they are saying what they are, why they say what they are saying. So I know ideas to get the students to speak in class and to practice for the speaking exam in a way that is more relaxed.
And that's very important. They're giving the reason part, especially at these higher levels, because that's expected very much so at B2, C1 and C2, that they extend the answer. So it's very important to show these examples where the students are doing that successfully.
And that's the opportunity to produce language, which is the purpose of the test, isn't it, Sarah?
Absolutely. Okay, and then that takes us to moving on to using images. And again, images are used in all three levels of these tests, so at B2, C1 and C2. At B2, obviously this is the long term, where the candidates are given a pair of photos to talk about, and then the second candidate will be asked a question as well. Also at C1 Advanced, they are looking at photographs. This time they're given three, but they're asked to choose to talk about two of them. And again, the second candidate will be asked a question. In C2 Proficiency, they're given written and visual stimuli, which is used in decision-making progress, making tasks. So they'll be discussing it, and then they'll be making a decision about the content. Now, it's very useful to look at the kind of language that they should be using for each of the levels. And we can see that at B2, they're comparing and describing and expressing opinions. But as we move up higher, it's expected that they should also definitely be speculating. And as we go to C2 Proficiency, we're looking at speculating, evaluating and reaching a decision through that negotiation and that, if you like, that interaction between the candidates in that particular task.
Yeah. And that's interesting to see this progression, Sarah, because that resembles something that many teachers know and use, which is Bloom's taxonomy. This Bloom's taxonomy is a framework of skills. And then when we look at skills such as speculating, evaluating, etc., that shows higher order thinking skills, which is expected when you are communicating at higher levels. So it's not just a case of knowing high level language and have, you know, a wide range of vocabulary, but also knowing what to do with this to communicate and use higher order thinking skills like evaluating, negotiating, speculating, etc.
And it's definitely not just about describing the pictures that they see. And even at B2, we'll see a little bit of speculation there as well. So definitely helping students see that it's not just the vocabulary about the pictures, it's working around the pictures as well.
Mm-hmm. And that's a frequent question from teachers. Okay, what's the main difference between a C1 level a candidate and a B2 level candidate? Well, you can see here from the progression, know how they are expected to be able to use language. So I think this is interesting to point out. Well, speaking of pictures, Sarah, we have another suggestion of tasks for teachers. This time we're going to focus on a video clip from B2 First for Schools. The idea here is for you to use the video to show the students so they listen to the recording and then they can assess the candidate's performance by looking at a checklist. For example, they are going to listen and watch to two candidates, and they have to make sure that whether or not those candidates have answered the questions, did they or not? Did the candidate speak about both pictures? Did they compare and contrast the pictures? Were the expressions to speculate used while they were describing the pictures? Do you think the students used very simple language, like good, nice, or do you think the students used a variety of language, so using more interesting synonyms of those words? For example, interesting, amazing, it was a memorable experience, etc., etc. So you're going to watch the video clip, and then you're going to say yes or no to each of those points here. So when you type your answers in the chat, you can write the number one, and then you can write yes or no for each of those points. Let's go.
They show people spending time in the mountains for different reasons. I'd like you to compare the photographs and say what you think people are enjoying about spending time in the mountains, all right?
Okay, so the first picture shows a group of kids and I think and one adult who are skiing. Maybe they live near the mountains and they are on a school trip. The second picture shows three people, but they don't seem to be together, they don't seem to be a group. The first, the one in the middle is a woman who is like staring at the mountains that are in front of her, and the other guys seem to be like going back. As for the weather, in the first picture it seems to be very cold, of course, because there is snow and they are like their clothes show that. Well, in the second one, it still seems cold, it's not warm, but it's not as cold as the first one. And I think the people are enjoying about spending time in the mountains is that in the first one, maybe, as I said, they're on a class trip and they are learning a new sport or just having fun with their classmates. Well, on the second one, maybe they are on a trip and Thank getting you. To know new places.
Thank you. They show people.
All right, Sarah, how's the chat going?
Yes, very busy. Lots of comments. And we've got some people listing yes, yes, yes. Some people saying no to number four and number five. So quite a variety of answers. So I think we need a little bit of help there, Alberto.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I'm going to show you the answers. And there is something interesting as well about those speaking test videos is that when you access the video, either from our website or from our YouTube channel, English with Cambridge, you can also download the examiner comments that come with the video. So you can see the examiner's notes as well as the grades that the candidates were awarded. So here, for example,
they show people spending time in the
We can say yes to all those points. So the candidate managed to communicate quite a lot and making use of the pictures. And this is, for example, if you want to say, if you want to find out why they were given yes to all those points, you can look at the examiner comments. We're going to be talking about this resource in a minute. But there is an interesting point about this task, Sarah. The examiner says, thank you at one point when the candidate
yes.
is speaking.
No, it's very, I think that's a very important to notice that. I think we need to get candidates to notice how the examiners behave. And one of the things that the examiner will do is when the time is up, they will say thank you. They will make no comments. They don't say well done or thank you or the excellent or any comments like that. They can't. But the indication that the time is finished is thank you. Now, the candidate shouldn't worry about that if they're still speaking. That's a good thing because they're obviously using the time. And if the examiner needs to move on to the next part of the test because of the time is up, the examiner will say thank you. And the candidate needs to know from that means thank you, stop speaking. We need to move on to the next part of the test. It's not that they're not listening to you, it's just that we've run out of time. And that's a really important thing because, of course, the examiners are being very neutral, friendly, but they won't be making any comment about what the candidates say.
Exactly. So thank you very much, Sarah. Again, with this exam practice, once you have done the video and you have checked the answers and maybe you might want to share the examiner comments as well, you can get the students to perform the speaking task again. For example, in groups of three, one student will be the examiner, the other one will be candidate one, and the other one will be candidate two. And then if you want to say, oh, where can I access those resources? You can go to the exam preparation section of our website where you can download the sample tests. And the sample tests will also bring the materials for the speaking test, like the examiner's script, the images, and everything that you need to get the students to practice for the test in class. So the examiner takes responsibility for choosing a set of questions and then they time like 1 minute and then you will complete the checklist above, right? And also you can set a similar task to allow students to practice for C1 and C2, because the sample we used here was a sample from B2 first for schools. And then you can also understand the dynamics of each speaking test.
And I think, Alberto, you made a very important point, is looking at the trios. So the nice thing about the new videos is that there are examples of the three. And I think it's very important that students know what to expect, so that when they do it in two, or if they are in three, what happens? And they'll see that obviously there's a little bit more extra time when they're in three. But of course, the test remains the same. But I think it's very important that students should be ready just in case they do find themselves in a trio as well.
Exactly. So, and we also have ideas, right, Sarah, to get the students to notice how language is used?
Yes. Now, this is really important. Of course, it helps students have the confidence that they're using the kind of language that's expected. So we've got an example here looking at useful expressions for talking in part two. And of course, what we need the students to do is look at those expressions and then put them into the right category. And I think we've got a little table here. So whether they're organizing their response, whether they're describing the photo, or very importantly, how they're comparing the photos. And they can look at they can notice perhaps when they watch the video, if any of these expressions are actually being used by the candidates. But first they can put them in the categories themselves, and then perhaps listen to the video and see if the candidates are using any. And I think we've got the answers on the next one. So there we go. And again, these are materials that you will be able to download, and you can do similar things, get students to notice, for example, when they are reaching a decision, what language they could use for that part of the test. And again, you'll find these kind of tables for those expressions also available in the materials that we're going to share with you.
Mm-hmm. And this is also a good opportunity to bring variety to students' language while doing the speaking test, right, Sarah? And we have them for the other levels too. We have similar activities.
That moves on to the important part, is the assessment criteria. And I think you're going to take us through that better, because understanding the criteria obviously can help you think about your performance and how to focus on different aspects of the speaking test. So Alberto.
And that's by understanding the criteria that we can give students sound feedback on their performance, right, Sarah? It's very important. So as we mentioned, you can go to the YouTube channel, English with Cambridge, and there you can access the playlist of speaking test videos. You can also do that by scanning the QR code here on this slide. And this is the screenshot of the video that is playing now. But if you go to this area here of the video, of the screen, you will find a PDF with the examiner's comments. And then you can use that, you know, as a reference to understand performance. And also that can be an inspiration for you to give students feedback on how they perform. And then you can also see the candidates' grades, the candidates who are on the video. So this is an idea of what the examiner's comments look like. So each speaking test video will bring those comments with detailed feedback on candidates' performance plus the individual grades. And this is really important to help us understand how the criteria are used to assess learners in the speaking test. So you can use those comments to draw students' attention to specific exam criteria. For example, we are going to do a task here, and we're going to focus on one of the points in the criteria, which is interactive communication, which is common to all three exams that we are talking about here. B2 first for schools, C1 advanced, and C2 proficiency. For example, when we talk about interactive communication, one of the things that the candidates need to do is make sure that they can initiate the conversation and respond appropriately. And it's important that because they are doing the task in pairs or in threes, they add their contributions to their partners and make links as well. So it's important that they develop their ideas, and they also develop their own points. And also they understand the turn taking, when to start speaking and when to allow partners to speak. Are they interacting with ease? Is it easy for them to interact, or do they tend to dominate or not to participate? So it's important that they show that they can link their contributions and also develop topics effectively. So what we're going to show here is we have two candidates, Teresa and Antonio. And as you watch them performing an interactive task, who does those things, do you think? Teresa or Antonio? So you can put T for Teresa or A for Antonio in plus adding the number here. Of course, we have similar points in the criteria, but we also have differences here to show degrees of performance. So watch the video and write T or A, T for Teresa or A for Antonio in terms of their performance doing the interactive task.
Now, I'd like you to talk about something together for about 2 minutes. Here are some things that people need to make decisions about and a question for you to discuss. First, you have some time to look at the task. Now, talk to each other about how important it is to get advice when making decisions about these things and why.
Well, I think, for example, work and studies is one of the most important, as it's something you're gonna be doing for a long term. And if you choose it badly, you're gonna have a lot of bad consequences. And if you're not sure, you should go to someone and ask them for them to guide you.
I absolutely agree with you, but on the other hand, fashion and style, it's how you are and how it characterizes you and is your personally own style. So I don't think they much need advice from this subject. On the other hand, also travel and holiday opportunities, you might question their advice if they have gone to the country you are talking about, so you have an idea how it's like and how to manage your expenses.
I think you're right, but for example, talking about travel and holiday opportunities also is connected with money matters, as if you're gonna make an investment, for example, I think it's something you need to be really sure of doing, because you can not just go blindly towards it, and being guided and having someone to tell you what's the best thing and what's safer, it also really helps.
Yeah, managing your expenses, the school doesn't actually prepare you to that type of world and how you're going to divide it. So I think they could really use some advice there. So I would actually agree with you on the work and studies and money matters, but the free time activities and hobbies are absolutely crucial. When you got out of school, you have to do something, get your mind blown away by the activity, or just enjoy doing something for once.
Thank you. Now you have about a minute to decide which of these things it is most important to think about carefully.
Well, I personally think that money matters is one of the most important, as it's something that you're really going to need throughout your life and you need to know, but it's better if people help you to choose correctly. And the other options are also pretty good, but money matters stands up here.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with you. As I said, the school doesn't prepare you, but also you have to be careful about the advice you take, because sometimes it can go on into the negative effects of the money matters, and also be able to manage correctly and to actually know what you're doing is the most important part.
Yes, I agree.
Thank
you. Okay, Alberto, just before we go any further, I know that some people have had difficulty reading the questions, because I think maybe to do with the internet, they've been a bit blurred. Now we can see them again, or at least I can. So we could hear the sound. So not everybody was able to follow the questions, but hopefully we can look at that together, considering that people weren't able to see the text throughout the video.
Okay, thanks for this, Sarah. In case you are able to read the questions and watch and listen to the video, can you share your answers here?
Yes, for example, we've got lots of people sharing. Lots of people sharing. So some people were able to see it, but I'm aware that lots of people weren't. Now it seems that they can see the question. So probably I think you'll need to take us through it.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. So for example, number one, who do you think initiates and responds appropriately?
We've got different reasons. Yeah. Some say T, some say A. So again.
Yeah. Because we have some nuances here in those descriptors. For example, who develops the ideas mainly of their own points, in contrast with number four, which says who develops topics effectively and widens the scope of interaction, as well as negotiates their partners towards an outcome, with their partner towards an outcome. So you can see that we have similar descriptors, but with different nuances here of performance. Well, for the sake of time, and this is just an idea for you to use with your learners, we've shown where to go for the videos, for the examiner's comments, etc. And for the criteria, which is in the handbooks for teachers, we are going to share the answers with you, right? And these are the answers. For example, Teresa responds appropriately and develops ideas, but Antonio shows ease of interaction, and he also develops topics effectively and negotiates with Teresa towards an outcome. And that's what you can see according to the examiner's comments here that you can download from our YouTube channel or from our exam preparation section on the website. Of course, also Sarah, everyone is listening to this only once, but in the classroom, they can listen to it once to listen out for some things, and then they can watch and listen again. So this is up to the teacher.
Absolutely.
But here we are just doing a quick demonstration of how you can use the videos to work with the criteria.
So staying with the criteria,
yeah,
we're going to look at that in more detail.
Exactly. At this point, and because we were doing part one, part two, part three, we focused on one point of the criteria, which is interactive communication. But now we're going to look at the criteria for those three exams and consider similarities and differences. For example, when we look at the criteria for B2 first for schools, there are four points to take into consideration, which are grammar and vocabulary, discourse management, pronunciation, and interactive communication. If we're looking at level C1 and C2, there is a difference there. We have a separation of grammar and vocabulary, and then we have grammatical resource as one point in the criteria, and then lexical resource as a separate point in the criteria, plus discourse management, pronunciation, and interactive communication. So we can see that there is a difference in the way the rubrics are organized, right? And of course, you can access the rubrics and the descriptors and the grades in the handbooks for teachers for those exams. So when we look at those points in the criteria, we can see that the way they are worded make a difference. For example, we're going to try and help learners to recognize performance at their target level, but it's important that we teachers are aware of those differences in levels. We're going to look at three descriptors for grammatical resource, and each one comes from one level, B2, C1, and C2. What you're going to do is you're going to read those descriptors and decide, are they level B2, C1, or C2? So you can read, and then you can share your answers in the chat. And as you do so, you might want to highlight some differences between the descriptors. In what ways are they different?
Okay, we're getting some answers already.
That's great.
Okay, just give people a time to contribute. So lots of people are saying C1 for two, and they're saying, some people said C1 for three, so B1, two, well, so fast it's difficult to read. Okay, well, it stops one, some people, yes, there's lots of different answers here, Alberto.
Yeah,
so
okay.
I think, again, it would be helpful to focus on the words in the descriptor that help teachers and learners appreciate the difference.
Exactly, Sarah. So we're going to look at the key now. So we have number one, level C2, number two, level B2, and number three, level C1. But in what ways are those descriptors different? So for example, when we look at level B2, which is descriptor number two, we can see here shows a good degree of control of a range of simple and some complex grammatical form. So we're not talking about complex, but some complex.
Is that word, isn't it? Yes,
yeah,
that
X. That's the key word.
Absolutely.
When we look at C1, for example, which is number three here, it says maintains control. When you maintain control, it's a bit different from showing a good degree of control, right? So you maintain control of a wide range of grammatical forms. So it's similar to number one, which is level C2. You do that, you maintain control of a wide range of grammatical forms, but you also use them with flexibility, which shows you have a lot more control and you can use them with great ease. So that's one important thing. So when you look at the criteria, everyone, make sure you pay attention to those words, because it's those words that will show you the difference between one level and the other. And of course, you have the examiner's comments and the videos to illustrate this to your learners. So we're going to continue with this, Sarah. We
yes.
have, for example, one sample here from one of the candidates on the video.
It's a good example of good degree of control, because if you look at the example here that you've given, be able to put them on practice on your everyday life. Now, it's not quite perfect, but the communication is there. And we can see that it's a good degree of control, and it's quite complex, but it's not quite perfect. But we can,
exactly.
With the message, the communication is there, the message is clear, which is very important. Because,
exactly.
Of course, it would put them into practice in your everyday life if we want to look at the complete version.
But I mean, in the context, this would be easily understood by an interlocutor, right, Sarah?
Which is very important. It's that communication.
Exactly. So this is one sample, and at level B2, showing a good degree of control. And we also have another sample from Antonio, the video we showed here, right, Sarah?
Yes, and his example is actually, we thought when we were looking at it, that this is a very good example. It's at the top of the range of C1. And if you're going to make an investment, for example, it's something you need to be really sure of doing, but you cannot just go blindly towards it. It's obviously, you know, a wide range of grammatical forms, and obviously there's a lot of control there. So
yeah,
an excellent example at the top end of the range.
And it's a long sentence with lots of language here, variety, etc. So it's quite elaborate in that respect, isn't it?
Absolutely.
So I agree, Sarah. It's the top end of level C1, almost reaching level C2 over here. So this is a good thing, everyone. And we got those samples from the examiner's comments. And it's interesting because you can bring this to your learners to show nuances of differences and highlight some key points of language production, right? But Sarah, we have so many resources to share, don't we?
Absolutely. And we talked about many, but how do you find them? So if we look on the next slide, we can see this is obviously from the website. So for every level that we've discussed, B2, C1 and C2, you can look at the preparation pages, which gives you information about the exam and also takes you to the exam essentials. And if you go to the exam essentials, this will, you're clicking on that part, will give you this list. And of course, this list is where you find the speaking test video with the examiner comments. So that's one way you can access it. You saw also from YouTube, Alberta showed you that you could also access the examiner comments from below on the YouTube as well, which is very important. Then we have another page which shows teacher proficiency as an example. We've also included the QR codes for the other levels so you can find it easily. And again, looking at the exam essentials, you'll find obviously lots of information, including the speaking test videos, but also we can go to the handbooks, which we just saw quickly on the next slide. And the handbooks, of course, give you the detail of the speaking test, the different parts of the speaking test, how they are assessed, what the examiners are looking for in each part of the test. And again, these are downloadable, and you will see whether you're taking the paper-based test of any of these exams, or if you're taking the new Cambridge English qualifications in the digital format, you will find the speaking test is still with a person in presence, let's say, face-to-face. And of course, you'll find examples of the test in the handbook.
And you can find the tables with the criteria, which I think are really important for you to look at.
Speaking test criteria. Is that so? The ones that Alberto was describing, you've got the full list, the full details for each one of the criteria. Test and Train is another place that you can find examples to practice with. And the self-study version is just mentioned here. Again, available at the different levels.
And now, Sarah, we come to the end of the session, don't we?
We do. Yes, we do. So we've been looking at reasons for using the speaking test videos and the importance of getting to know the speaking test and how the videos can help you and your candidates do that. Of course, we're looking at understanding the criteria so that you as a teacher and your candidates are well informed of what's expected. We've looked at some examples of part one and the spoken questions that students might be asked. Some images, looking at part two, where they talk about an image or the photos. And again, understanding the criteria with some examples from the examiner comments, which we recommend you have a look at. And of course, we hope that you can see also other resources that are available, which leaves us a tiny bit of time to look at some questions. So I think Kate has answered many as we were going through. So let's have a look what we still have to answer. Okay, so there is a question about the collaborative task. Do candidates necessarily need to reach a conclusion, especially for C2? Violetta asks us that question. Would you like to say something about that, Roberto?
Yeah, exactly. Well, they don't necessarily have to, but it's important that they negotiate with their partner towards this goal. So this is the idea for the task, is to get the students to negotiate, speculate, and then try to go together towards this goal of reaching a conclusion, because it's by trying, by attempting to do this, that you will be using a lot of language to do all those things that Sarah illustrated so well, negotiating, speculating, etc. All those higher order thinking skills, along with a wide range of language.
In fact, somebody else always makes a comment, can they agree to disagree? Which of course is coming to a conclusion. So that's a very, exactly. That's valid as well. There are also questions and comments about the B2 speaking test. Whoops, it's just moving and I need to move it back. So does the examiner expect to hear the students speculating, or should they compare the pictures? Well, I hope we've answered that question, because obviously they need to compare, but they can also obviously include some speculation as part of that part of the task. Are there handbooks for students? Because we have handbooks for teachers.
Yeah, we have the information for candidate booklets for each of the exams. In the exam preparation section that Sarah mentioned a minute ago, you can also find in the learner essentials the information for candidate booklet for each of the exams. And that has information that is conveyed in a way that, you know, is accessible for learners. So feel free to download and share the information for candidate booklets with your learners.
Okay. So one person is asking if they should use a full lesson focused on speaking or using the videos with an inductive approach to teach target language, or both, or something else. So that's a very complex question, but it shows the variety. I don't know what you want to say something about that, Alberto.
Yeah, I mean, I think the idea is for you to bring the videos and the other ideas to your class. And you don't have to do like one dedicated lesson for the speaking test, but you can break it down and do different activities in different classes. And then you can also connect the activities with the tasks in the course book that you are using or in the materials that you bring to class. You know, in case, for example, your course book brings a set of images in a unit, you can also make use of the images to practice the speaking test, and then you can bring a snippet of the video focusing on images to practice with your learners. So you can break it down and do different activities in different classes just to add more variety to what you already do.
And I think this is a kind of relevant question to that, because Annette asks about whether the candidates see the guiding question when they're given the pictures to respond to. And of course, when they... Yes, sorry, Alberto, yeah.
No, for example, B2, you have two pictures and you have one key question in the material. And if you want to find out more, we recommend downloading the sample tests, and then you will see the sample as they are for the learner too.
And so, yes, they do see the question. And if you look at the sample material, you'll be able to reassure the students that they will hear and be able to see the question. So it helps them to focus. We're also being asked about practice activities, and someone mentions that they have heard of Write and Improve, and they're wondering about if there's anything for speaking.
Can I say that?
Yes.
Can I answer that, Sarah?
Exactly.
We have Speak and Improve, which is in a way similar to Write and Improve in the sense that the platform uses artificial intelligence to give learners feedback on performance. If you go to Speak and Improve, you will be able to practice speaking with our robot called Sandy. She
yes.
asks you questions, and then you answer the questions, and then Sandy will give you feedback, taking into consideration the Common European Framework of Reference, right?
It's great fun.
Yes, it's great fun, and you can use it in any kind of device, but we have something new to Write and Improve. You know, there is an area that you can register for. You don't have to pay for anything, it's free. And then you have other activities to practice speaking. For example, if you want to practice describing a picture only, you can do that by going to that section. And you also have a series of tests with parts 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., for you to practice speaking as if you were taking an exam. So you can click on part 1, listen to the questions, respond, and then get feedback from Sandy, our lovely robot from Speak and Improve.
Absolutely. It's good practice. And then, of course, we can do it with a live candidate and a live examiner. So, of course, it's not tested by computer.
Yeah.
So, yes, I think that really brings us to the end, don't you think, Alberto? We want to say really thank you to everyone for joining us. We hope you found this useful. The resources, obviously, will be the recording of the session will be sent to you after the event. And of course, then you will have the links to the resources. But I would like to say a big thank you to Alberto for doing this with me. It's been great to be here with everyone. So thank you, and Alberto.
Yeah, thank you everyone for your active participation throughout the webinar. And thank you, Sarah, once again for joining efforts so that we can put this together to support teachers all over the world. It was a pleasure to be with you again, Sarah, and to be with all of you talking about those wonderful resources, the speaking test videos. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you, and goodbye.
Goodbye.